On April 10th, 2019, the very first image of a black hole will be released to the public, and we're going to preview it and understand this remarkable scientific achievement starting now. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. Chances are by now you've already seen the very first image of a black hole. Well, this video is designed to put that image into proper context by understanding what was involved in making it. Now, I'm making this video just a couple of days before the announcement, so I'm living in that era of humanity where human beings have never really seen an image of a black hole before. Lucky you, but I'll catch up, don't worry. Anyway, so let's take a quick look at how black holes have been depicted traditionally. When we think about black hole images, they're usually surrounded by a disk of gas and dust that is circling at very high speed, some of it's falling into the black hole, some of it being accelerated out in bipolar jets. Now, these illustrations are very useful for understanding the geometry of the black hole and its accretion disk. However, if we were to look upon this black hole and its accretion disk with our own eyes, we would see something necessarily different. And that's because black holes, like any massive object in the universe, distort space-time around it. And light follows a path around this distorted or curved space-time, and so it gives us a warped picture of the environment surrounding the black hole. In the 1970s, Jean-Pierre Lumine worked out what a black hole should look like. He envisioned a black hole surrounded by an accretion disk, and, using the technology available at the time, a photographic plate, kind of looking down on the black hole and its disk from a slight angle. The light from above the disk forms essentially the primary image. But light from underneath the disk would also be deflected by the black hole and would be redirected towards our photographic plate, producing a secondary image. Lumine worked out the path that light would take around a rotating black hole. He then plotted each photon on a piece of paper, producing a virtual photograph, literally a graph of every photon. The first thing you notice is that there's a really bright region on the left-hand side. The black hole is rotating, and so is the material in its accretion disk. As that material is rotating toward us, however, it is moving at nearly the speed of light. That means that the light gets stacked up, and the intensity of that light coming toward us is increased. This is an effect called Doppler beaming, or relativistic boosting, and it's the reason why the left side of the disk appears to be so bright. Meanwhile, on the right side of the disk, the material is rotating away from us at nearly light speed, stretching out the wavelengths of light, making them dimmer and dimmer. So we get a very bright right side and a ghostly, very difficult to see left side. Now, exactly how this disk appears to us is going to depend on our viewing angle. In the upper right-hand corner of this simulation, we can see a single hot spot in the accretion disk. As we change our viewing angle, we can see how the black hole's gravity distorts and brightens the hot spot as it rotates into our field of view. But all of this is purely theoretical. In order to test relativity, we need to make an image of a black hole. And if it looks anything like what we expect, then that is pretty much the most stringent test of relativity we can come up with. Fortunately, our galaxy is home to a 4 million solar mass black hole. It's in the direction of the constellation Sagittarius, and so we call it Sagittarius A star, or Sag A star. We can't see Sag A star at visible wavelengths because of all the intervening gas and dust. But if we switch to infrared, we can make out individual stars as they orbit the black hole. These observations allow us to make very precise measurements of Sag A star's mass, as well as its overall size. The object turns out to be about 4 million solar masses and has a diameter of about 24 to 44 million kilometers. However, at 26,000 light years away, Sag A star would be just 5.3 millionths of an arc second on the sky. To give you an idea just how tiny an angle that is, let's consider a soccer ball. It's about 22 centimeters in diameter, and our eyes can make out a soccer ball at a distance of about 3/4 of a kilometer. Now, obviously, that depends on your eyesight, but on average, the human eye can resolve down to about 60 seconds of arc. The Hubble Space Telescope can do much better. It can see down to 5/100 of a second of arc. Even so, that is about 10,000 times too low a resolution to image Sag A star. In other words, we need a bigger telescope. We can link multiple telescopes together using a technique called interferometry. This, however, requires ultra-precise timing so that the light from each telescope converges at the same time to form a single image. And that sets a practical limit on just how far apart our telescopes can be. However, at longer wavelengths, the timing requirement is a little less stringent, so longer baselines are possible. However, the longer the wavelength, the larger the telescope has to be in order to achieve the desired resolution. Even microwaves, which are about a millimeter across, are so gigantic of a wave that in order to see down to 53 microarcseconds, you need a telescope the size of planet Earth. Interferometry at the planetary scale requires very long baselines. We even call this technique VLBI for very long baseline interferometry. Interferometry uses a pair of telescopes separated by some baseline. Due to the angle of the target and the curvature of the Earth, light is going to hit one receiver first. That means that the time difference in the arrival of the signals has to be accounted for. In the case of the Event Horizon Telescope, observations had to be conducted simultaneously and synchronized using atomic clocks. The Event Horizon Telescope consists of several telescopes around the globe: the Submillimeter Array and the James Clerk Maxwell Telescope at Mauna Kea, the Submillimeter Telescope at Mount Graham, Arizona, the Large Millimeter Telescope in Mexico, the IRAM 30-meter telescope in Pico Valleta, Spain, the Atacama Millimeter and Submillimeter Array, or ALMA, in Chile, and the South Pole Telescope at the South Pole Station in Antarctica. The 77-meter Greenland Telescope joined EHT for a second round of observations. EHT can be thought of as a mirror the size of Earth, but it's more accurate to describe it as fragments of a mirror scattered around the Earth. That means each fragment can only form a piece of the image. Luckily, Earth's rotation allows those antennae to sweep out a wider swath of the sky, so it does help to fill in the rest of the image. But how do you reconstruct a true image when all you have are image fragments? Well, let's imagine what we would see if we could only take images of a given subject. Well, if we look at this image, we can start to make out some familiar shapes, patterns, colors, textures, and before long, your brain is probably filled in that what we are really looking at is an image of an apple. Now, that's easy for us because we know what an apple looks like. What exactly will Sag A star look like? Well, fortunately, we can run some theoretical computations using supercomputers to produce a virtual image. These are general relativistic magnetohydrodynamic simulations. In this image, we're looking at the black hole at about a 45-degree angle. From that, we can then take all the possible images that can be derived from the image fragments and rank them from least likely to most likely. The most likely image is the best representation of what it is we are actually seeing. These observations are extremely difficult to make, and in December 2018, Tony Darnell and myself talked with Dr. Jeffrey Bauer from EHT. I'll have a link to that conversation right here and in the description below, so definitely check that out because it's a fascinating conversation. And please join me in thanking my Patreon supporters for their generous support in making this video possible. And if you'd like to talk more about what we learned through EHT, make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you're notified when that video comes out. Until then, stay curious, my friends.